sorry. I'm sorry, guys.
That's all right, man. That's okay. He was like, guys, we are back. This is Let Your Voice Be Heard on WHCR 90.3 FM, The Voice of Harlem. We're talking to Tim Mack from Politico about Obama's second term. If you guys have any questions or any comments, you just want to chime in, please call us up at 212-650-6903. And now, Tim, I have a friend, Tamara, here. She's learning about broadcasting, but she has a question for you. And we want to go back to what we're talking about, climate change, right, Tamara?
Yeah.
So go right ahead.
Okay. Hi, Tim. This question is a little bit more theoretical, I guess, but I think that whenever we talk about the environment and climate change, it's always viewed as this kind of alternative side topic that when things are going well in the nation and the economy's good, then it's like, okay, let's focus on these other things, education and the environment. But I think that we need to start incorporating that into the conversation about the economy and these seemingly more pressing topics. So do you think that our inability to do that in Congress and even in our society is like an issue with prioritizing? Or do you think we're just having a difficulty seeing all of these issues as being interconnected? And if so, how can we kind of change that in our conversations or in politics?
I think it's a function of the short-sightedness of politics. I mean, politics is based off the 2-year or 4-year election cycle, whereas climate change is something that takes place over a long period of time. And, you know, I think if we've seen anything from Washington, it's that if they can punt it, if they can delay it, if they can put it off for someone else, for it to be someone else's problem, they'll do it. They don't want to take responsibility, and they're not going to take responsibility. And you see that very often with people of both parties. And I think that's one of the crucial problems with the issue, is that education takes a long time to change. You know, even when we're looking at a fiscal cliff, these two parties are having a very hard time coming together to agree on something.
Wow.
So when it comes to something as long-term as climate change, you gotta wonder how they're going to agree on something when they have unlimited time or a very long time.
Right. Oh.
Really unfortunate. It's almost like these issues are becoming like a hot potato.
Nobody wants to grab onto it, right?
Yeah, they just want to keep passing it off. And
then our kids are going to be dealing with it. I think that's kind of what it is. It's just like somebody else will deal with it. I don't want to tackle it. And guys, once again, this is Let Your Voice Be Heard. We're on with Tim Mack from Politico. If you guys want to call in or chime in, the number is 212-650-6903. And I want to move this along. I mean, I think we talk about the fiscal cliff, climate change, and I want to talk about immigration reform. I'm Hispanic, and I was interviewed about why I voted for Obama, and I think I was the only one that actually did not mention immigration, and I was very honest. I said, I live in New York City. You know, I came here with a green card. I'm a citizen. It doesn't affect my everyday life. I voted on a lot of other issues, women's rights being primarily, reproductive rights being primarily the reason why I voted for Obama. But this is not about me, because still the Latinos voted overwhelmingly for Obama. I think it was 71% to 27%, if I'm correct. Is that correct? Do you know? I think it was.
So you're saying the Hispanic vote for Obama?
Yeah, yeah.
It was, I think it was 79 to 21.
It was that much.
That's a landslide.
That is a really big landslide. And I'm not definitely not a political expert, but I believe that most of the reasons why Latinos voted for Obama was because of the Dream Act and, you know, his policy of opening up college to children of undocumented immigrants. Now, still, I mean, it was something that we talked about it and it gave people some kind of hope, but nothing much was done. I mean, do you think that in his second term he'll tackle immigration reform to make like a path to citizenship for these people?
Yeah, I just rethought the numbers. It was 71 to 29, not 79 to 20.
Yes, still a landslide.
71 for Obama, 29 for.
Must be all those gifts.
But I mean, look, after the election, one of the things that you're hearing a lot from the Republican side is a new open willingness to discuss immigration reform. Actually, one of Mitt Romney's top advisors, the former Commerce Secretary Luis Gutierrez, has just this morning has started a new political action committee to support Republicans who want to do comprehensive immigration reform. These things, after the election, now that you know, people don't have to worry so much about the political implication of the presidential cycle, a lot of people are talking about how Republicans are going to negotiate some sort of immigration reform. You might see it. I mean, I think it's one of the few things where you might be able to get Republicans and Democrats to come together.
That is actually really, really good news. I really didn't think that Republicans were interested in immigration reform in the way that we see it, like the DREAM Act. But you have a question, Sam?
Yeah, we might see. Do you think it'll be a lot closer to what Obama was pushing with the DREAM Act, or would it be, like, very altered?
Well, I mean, I think Republicans are still grappling with how they can have a principled opposition to the president while still getting some of what they want. In order to really pass anything through Congress nowadays, you have to have some muddle between what Democrats want and what Republicans want. And Republicans, I think, have always said, we want to secure the border in some more dramatic way, whether it's a fence, whether it's putting more troops on the border. And you're going to bet, if there's any sort of comprehensive immigration deal, they're going to want to trade. They're going to say, we want to shut down the border to prevent illegal immigration, but also to create a path for legal immigration for those who are already here. That's going to be the trade, and that's something that John McCain in the past has supported. That's something that that Marco Rubio is interested in, supposedly. So there are people that are high and senior in the Republican Party who are interested in immigration reform, which presents an opening.
Yeah, I agree with you with McCain there. I definitely have read a lot about him. And for me, I thought Marco Rubio is the key. I mean, he definitely looks like he would like to be president one day eventually. And I think the only way that he can actually secure it, Hispanic people are not going to vote for him just because he's Hispanic. I mean, I'm definitely not. So for me, he would have to do something. He would have to give me something. You know, Obama gave me an Obama phone. I'm kidding.
I was going to say, where'd you get that?
I'm still waiting for my present, Mr. Obama. I will vote again and vote for Romney this time.
Did you get your gift back, too?
I didn't get any gift back.
You must have voted for the other guy. Seriously, it came with a welfare check, an Obama phone. I'm just being silly. But seriously, so many people keep talking about this phone that I don't know. Oh, and free contraceptives, obviously. but anyway, like I said, I think immigration reform is super important. And I'm very happy to hear that Republicans, there are some important Republicans out there that are willing to find a path with these people. And I didn't hear you correctly. You said that the John McCain and Marco Rubio, they're interested, or the Republican Party, are they interested in just securing the border so that not more illegal immigrants come in, or are they also interested in helping the illegal immigrants that are already living in the United States?
I think that's the trade, right? I mean, Democrats would insist, I think Democrats would be push harder for that legal path to citizenship, whereas Republicans would insist more clearly on securing the borders. But I think you'll have elements of both in each side.
Well, I hope so, because I just can't imagine how we can continue on with this. And like I said, I understand, and it's a very difficult subject to talk about. I don't just approve, like I said, of open borders either. But, you know, we do have these people here, and they do pay taxes. You know, they buy things, and they help the economy. Go ahead.
I'm happy we're having this conversation, but Tim, I just want to bring up something that I think we don't really mention on the show. We have an immigration process. Why can't we just focus on finding a way to streamline that and make it a little cheaper? I spoke to one person who said that it costs about, I think, like $900 to apply for citizenship, and the process can take over 10 years. I mean, I could be wrong about the numbers, but I know it's a very arduous
expensive
process.
I'm uniquely positioned in this process because I'm an immigrant to the United States as well, and I'm actually in the process of getting a green card. I have a visa. I'm a work visa here.
Yeah.
And so I feel like uniquely positioned to speak about it. Right. It is extremely, extremely expensive. But when you add in lawyer fees, we're talking maybe 6 to 7 years and maybe $10,000 to get a green card. I mean, it's that expensive, and it's very difficult, and it takes a long time. And you're right. I mean, there are a lot of high-skilled people who I think are from other countries and are not illegal immigrants who would be disadvantaged if there were a process that suddenly legalized or created a path to citizenship for people who are out of status now.
What if they just found some way to, like I said before, accelerate or streamline this thing, make it cheaper? What if you're an immigrant? And this is my assumption, obviously. I don't know what I'm talking about.
if you're
an immigrant and you come from a country that's maybe impoverished, or you came here for a better financial, a stronger financial opportunity, who's to say that you had just had 15 $100 laying around to like start off with a basic investment for your citizenship. And maybe that's why so many people, I mean, I don't know this for a fact, but maybe that's why so many families don't even bother. They just come here, camp up and stay and get down. And the process, the bureaucracy for most federal things, as we know, can be a pain in the butt. If you don't believe me, go to the DMV on a Monday morning.
Oh, stop. Yeah. Same thing, right?
Yeah.
The issue is what kind of, I think the question that a lot of people are asking is, what kind of immigrants are we looking to attract most heavily? Are we looking to attract, very high-skilled, highly educated immigrants for a type of economy that's based on technology and ideas and that sort of thing?
Mm-hmm.
Or are we trying to attract lower-income immigrants with less education to do the jobs that Americans typically don't want to do, or some sort of mix? And how do we create incentives for both those groups to come in?
Wow. And I don't know the specific numbers, but I remember reading, I don't even remember who wrote it. I think it was Zakaria Ferreira. I don't remember who it was. it was a reporter, and he was talking about in Canadian immigration and how they usually, I mean, I think more than 60% of their immigrants are highly skilled workers. And you're Canadian, right?
Yes, yeah, I'm Canadian, and I'm trying to immigrate to the United States.
What happened? What happened to Canada? You don't like it?
No, I do. I love politics, and I love American politics, too. I guess for Canada, Canada has a system where they give up, they have a point system. You need to get 30 points in order to immigrate to Canada. And, you know, like if you have a college degree, that's 6 points. If you have some sort of training in a trade, that's 3 points. If you have family that's lived in Canada before, that's another 3 points. You just basically need to amass 30 points. And that encourages highly skilled, highly connected people to come to Canada.
That makes a lot of sense.
It does.
Why can't, I mean, I'm going to steal from Canada. What I do.
But I think also we can consider that a lot of the immigrants that come to the United States are impoverished. I don't think that many of them have college degrees and connections and things.
A lot of them have children who strive for these things and who are in school now, and they can eventually amass these points.
I agree.
And I have a bigger frustration, you know. We're talking about Latin Hispanic people as if they're the only immigrants. I know a whole bunch of European immigrants who are from freaking Switzerland and Russia and Ukraine, and they're immigrants. And you know, they're all cool. Like when I was registering people to vote, as I did this past election series, I registered a lot of people to vote, and the difference between people is so crazy. By Pratt, the a college in Brooklyn, I would ask someone to register, and it'd be like this beautiful, you know, young European girl, and she'd go, "Oh, I'm an immigrant, I can't vote," and she's just so cool with it. I go to South Bronx, ask the same question, and a 18-year-old boy is almost running from me because he is not a citizen.
And he feels a certain way.
Something is wrong here. Maybe along with immigration reform and trying to streamline the process, we need to change the way we think about immigration in general.
Right. I mean, but so the advantage that Canada has is it doesn't have a southern border filled with people trying to get into the country. It has the advantage of being able to pick and choose who comes in.
Right.
The problem that the United States has right now is that there are millions of people right now that are out of status who are you know, largely Hispanic and unable to, if they leave, they won't be able to come back. And if they stay here, they won't be able to have any sort of path to citizenship. It's true that, you know, the United States needs to do a better job of attracting high-skilled workers, but perhaps it's two separate problems. There's a problem of dealing with low-skilled workers that are already here and low-skilled workers streaming in from the southern border who want to come here, and then the additional problem of attracting high-skilled workers who are otherwise not already coming.
Right. No, I definitely understand because, you know, you talk about this 30-point system and it sounds fantastic. And I'm like, oh, I wish we could do that. I know so many great people living in other countries. I've traveled and I wish that they could come here because I feel that they have so much to offer. But, you know, they don't have that easy, you know, system that they can just accrue points and come. But then I also know the opposite spectrum of people that really have nothing where they're from and they just want a better life for their children. And then it's hard, you know. They probably come here and they're going to be earning very low wages, migrant workers and farm work. And I think we need two different approaches to this, you know. Maybe quotas? I don't know. Would that work?
There are already quotas.
We do. Okay.
There are already quotas for work visas.
Oh, I see.
In the United States, yeah.
Oh, okay. Well, I know, honestly, this issue is much more complicated than I can even imagine. Guys, by the way, this is Let Your Voice Be Heard on WHCR 90.3 FM. We're talking with Tim Mack of Politico, and if you guys have any questions, call us at 212-650-6903. We're talking about Obama's second term. I totally forgot we're talking about Obama because we went over immigration reform. But bringing it back to Obama, though, and immigration, you know, his approach was the DREAM Act. But for me, that only helps the people that are already here, these undocumented immigrants that have children here and or they come very young. But what happened? Does that help with the people that want to come in later on? Or doesn't at all? Is there an approach? Is there somebody working on something?
Well, you know, Marco Rubio was working on some legislation before the president issued an executive order on, like, DREAM Act-esque, DREAM Act-like stuff, you know, creating a path to citizenship for certain people. You know, it doesn't so much help people in the future. I mean, it is strictly for people who, when they were young, were brought into the United States illegally and through no fault of their own are in a situation where they have no status. And if they, you know, go to college or sign up for military service, they're given some ability to earn their path to citizenship.
Right.
But for future people, it doesn't really help.
Fair enough. Well, I'll help you find a way. And, you know, we have to close up quickly, so I don't know if quickly as you can, Tim, can the Middle East, that's a really, really big hot potato. So we like to talk about it. And now with the situation going on in Gaza and Israel, in Syria, you know, what happened with the Palestinians, there's a lot of things going on in the Middle East. Do you think Obama is going to be able to tackle all of that?
Well, you know, we're basically on the edge of war right now with Gaza and Israel. It's stunning how quickly over the last week we've seen rockets fired, and now we're on the brink of an all-out war and a ground assault from Israel into the Gaza Strip.
Right.
Meanwhile, Egypt is still kind of teetering. We don't know what kind of government we'll see there. Will it be an Islamist government? Or how highly influenced will it be by Muslim values as opposed to other values?
Mm-hmm.
And of course, Syria, we're also looking at a civil war essentially there with a dictator killing his own people. All over the place, we're seeing really very difficult situations for the president to handle. And I'm not sure what the president wants to do or proposes to do about it exactly. He hasn't been the most engaged on this idea.
You know,
the president releases a statement here and there, but you don't see him leading the charge on anything or just taking a stand or anything like that. It doesn't seem to interest him nearly as much as, say, the fiscal cliff, which is coming. You know,
the president now
is not even in Washington, D.C. He's in Thailand. He's going to be traveling throughout Asia over the next couple of days. Meanwhile, the Middle East is kind of in turmoil.
It is. And do you think that the situation, considering that we consider Israel an ally during the debate, both presidential candidates said, yes, Israel is our ally and we are on their side. Do you think that we would be getting involved if this continued to escalate?
You mean in any sort of military capacity?
Yes, like a military intervention in Israel or on
the side?
I hope not either. Doubt that. I mean, that's,
you doubt
that's,
that. Good.
Good.
I strongly doubt that because the U.S. military is already so invested in Israel. I mean, firstly, we're talking about millions of dollars in economic aid every year goes to Israel from the United States. Most of it is used for military capacity. And so while the U.S. military may not be directly involved in this conflict, the American taxpayer already is.
Oh, all right. Well, Tim, we ran out of time, but thank you so much for all that insightful information. I feel like 100 times smarter because I talked to you. You have that gift, really. And Tim, can you just let us know where we can read more about your writings or what you do?
Sure. I write for Politico.com. That's Politico with an O at the end. And I'm on Twitter at Tim K. Mack, TimKMak. You can follow me there.
All right. Thank you so much, Tim. You have a great Sunday, and we loved having you.
All right, thanks, guys.
All right. Guys, this is Let Your Voice Be Heard on WHCR 90.3 FM, the voice of Harlem. We will be... He hung up on us, huh? We will be right back with the news roundup. Stay tuned.
WHCR 90.3 FM, New York.
I want you to take over control. Take over control. Take over control. Oh, I want you to take over control. Plug it in and turn me on.
Baby, can't you see that I'm giving all the free? So it's up to you now. We could let time pass away or make an excuse to play, but it's up to you now. Just wanna fulfill your needs while you're taking over me. So what do you want now? Take a picture, make a show, cause nobody has to know all the ways that we get down.
I want you to take over control. Take over control. Take over control.
Guys, this is Let Your Voice Be Heard on WHCR 90.3 FM. We are here with Stanley and Kwanzaa and Tamara and Lanice, right? Did I say your name right? Oh, I got it. And this is Patricia. We just finished talking with Tim Mack from Politico about Obama's second term. We learned a lot. He's one of the smartest guys that I know, and I was very excited about that. But now we're going to the news roundup. So if you guys have anything, you want to chime in, you want to say any stories that you heard over the week, it was funny, silly, stupid, interesting, call us at 212-650-6903. What happened, Stanley? You were like pointing at me. You were going all over the place.
No, before you got... Don't judge me. I'm being super productive over here. Before we even go to the news roundup thing, I'm going to say this, and this may destroy my future political career, mm-hmm. but I really hope we don't go to war because of Israel.
I hope so,
honestly,
too.
I mean, I know... I don't really know what's happening over there between Israel and Gaza and Palestine or whatever, but I just don't agree with anyone dying, and I definitely don't agree with us sending our troops over there to die for something that I'm not even fully able to comprehend or understand. And, you know, not to, like, you know, build myself up, but I think I'm pretty good at understanding what's going on in politics and in the world, and I see no reason to shed blood over this. We should stay home.
I totally agree, and we certainly can't afford another war.
Right.
That is exactly what I was about to say. I know I can't spend any more federal dollars.
No. Put that in our education. Oh, my
Please.
Goodness.
In healthcare.
It's making me really reconsider trying eventually being a mother. Like, seriously. Like, it's like this world. I mean, I don't like that. I didn't like the way that through my high school years, all I was thinking about was like, oh, we're in this economic downturn. This is such a depressing time because those are the best years for you to be excited and hopeful about your future. No. We all in here spent those years thinking like, oh, maybe one day we won't be able to find a job. Or what is the best major for you? Because it wasn't so much about what you like to do. It was about what's going to make you money eventually.
Exactly.
That's how people pick careers. When I tutor people, when I mentor kids, I tell them pick something that you like, but also think about whether you can find a job when you graduate. And it breaks my heart to say that because, you know, I really would like them to approach whatever they want. Yeah, go ahead, Lanice.
Yeah, I mean, since I'm in high school now, basically that's what my college counselors say to me right now. Like, yeah, you may like this, but also pick something productive, but also...
Go to engineering.
Yeah. Yeah. But also, I refuse to pick something that I'm going to be bored with. So right. I feel like if I want to do this and I have passion for it, I'm going to stick with it, whether it makes me happy or not. I'm just that type of person. And even though I'm not afraid of, like, I was afraid of, like, oh, maybe there's no jobs. At the end of the day, I guess that's the type of person I am. I'm very positive. So I would still want to pick something I love. So I don't believe in that. But I know friends who are like,
yeah, she's
that.
Like, I don't believe that we're in an economic downturn.
Well, real quick, before I even go, I want to say real for you guys, if you're listening, you have some news you want to share with us, call. Number is 212-650-6903. And you can also tweet us. It's at @BeHeard_radio. Did I get that right, guys?
Yes, you did.
Yes.
Fist pump in the air. So, yes, that's...
I know.
Hit us up, guys. We want to hear stories. We want to talk about it. I want to jump in right now with some news. You guys have made me so self-conscious about that phrase.
Jumping in? This is very fair. I'm going to jump in.
She says that every single time.
It sounds very active. I like it.
You guys are racist, productive. And that's what the problem is.
Racist.
You are racist.
Black men can jump. Go ahead.
Hey, we can jump and play basketball. Thank you very much.
And jump the broom.
Yeah. Whoa. Let's not curse. No one's getting married over here, right? But I want to mention was we've been making jokes about gifts all show. And for those of you who had no idea what the heck we were talking about, Mitt Romney this week said to his donors, the reason that President Obama won the election was because he gave gifts to young people, blacks, Spanish, and women. Gifts like contraception, that's State University Education again.
The pill.
Contraceptives, like condoms and the pills and the day after pill, all those other good things, you know, you can go and just have you get your sex on with.
All the things that make you all slutty, right?
Exactly.
HPV vaccines.
Yeah,
obviously.
You skeezers. But along with that, he gave us free money for college, made college affordable, and told us that we had a right to eat. Yeah. So, you know, because Obama gave those gifts, you know, he felt that's why he lost the election. And he said that, you know, and in his defense,
right.
If you listen to the clip, which I did, and you guys can listen to it on our website, lyvbh.com, and my editorial called My Christmas Wish List.
Look at him just plugging himself in.
Yes.
My name is Blee.
It's related.
Yeah, I pretty much made a Christmas wish list to Obama since I didn't get a gift and I voted for him. And in that editorial, it lists my wish list. I want to get Kristen Stewart fired from all acting jobs and et cetera. But Romney says, yeah, Obama gives these gifts to black people and to Spanish people, and a Republican Party can no longer have a stance of just such, like, divisiveness towards Latins and women. He does say that. He says we had to be more proactive in reaching out to these people in the future.
Right.
So let me be clear that he did say that.
I don't really care anymore. He's done.
But, yeah. You know, he did say, yeah, we gave him gifts. And I just thought, wow. Before I heard that, I was like, you know, Mitt Romney isn't a bad guy. He's just a tool, and that's not his fault. No, he is just a tool, and he's just so disconnected from...
He is.
From anyone who doesn't have a garage elevator, he's disconnected from them, and it's scary.
He really is. Honestly, I mean, we laugh about it, but they really believe that, oh, he's just giving us free stuff, and that's why we voted. I don't want free stuff. I want human rights. That's what I really wanted. I want things that we should all be. And actually, I think it was the UN. They recently said, I think it was the UN. Look at me saying something wrong. But that contraceptions are a human right. That was the first time they've actually said that you have the right to plan your family, because that's basically what it is. It's not, let's just go out there, let's have sex without consequences. It's really about you deciding. No, I know. Can you believe it?
I thought it was
for that too. So that's why I was on board, but now apparently it isn't. No, I mean, it really is so much more than that. It's about you deciding when you want to have a family, when you want to stop having children, so that you can actually prosper and have some economic growth in your life. I'm sorry, but if I have 8 kids, there is no chance I'm going to be having a job too.
8 kids? I can barely deal with like 1 kid for 10 minutes. They're so annoying. Thank God for condoms and such.
Also, you know what thank God's for?
What?
Twinkies.
What?
Mm. They're gone.
Whoa. Are you serious?
Yes.
Where'd they go?
They were Hostess, the company that makes Twinkies. They said they shut down. 18,000 people lost their jobs because the unions couldn't come up with an agreement on, like, I believe it was pay raises. I don't know exactly. It was like an 8%. They wanted to cut down, I believe, people's salaries, and they just refused to. And they couldn't come up to an agreement. So that's it. They closed. No more Twinkies.
So that's Twinkies and every other snack?
Every other Hostess snack.
No.
All of them.
It's the cream filling. That's what made him go bankrupt.
This has been going on for the last couple of years, because when I was at LaGuardia, my professor, he writes for the New York Post, and he had to cover the story of them shutting down the Hostess that's that was on Jamaica, right off of Jamaica Avenue in Queens. Right. And he's like, he sees it, he foresees this being like a problem for the company as a whole. And I'm like, this is impossible. People can't live without Twinkies. And
what? That's really what you were saying. Well, you know,
they withstand. Meanwhile,
she was on her way to the gym.
Actually, I was after class. But,
shoving Twinkies out.
Yeah. And he brought a bunch of the stuff to class, and it was the captain.
I don't buy those snack cakes. I don't know.
Oh, I'm sorry.
I really don't. No, I don't.
Have a hostess snack cake.
Guys, I don't know. You're crazy, Kwanzaa.
Seriously, I tweeted about it, and I was like, well, everybody was like on my timeline. Oh my God, the Twinkies, and it's just really irritating because I'm like, seriously, people, there's so much more along with it. There's bad financial management and people losing their jobs.
Yeah.
So then I wrote like, you know, 18,000 people are losing their jobs, and everybody's all like crying about the Twinkies.
I feel bad.
And Mona Atahawi, who follows me on Twitter, she retweeted that. She has like 160,000 followers.
That's
oh my gosh. Yeah, we're buddies like that. But anyway, she tweeted me, and that was retweeted like 250 times, and I got so many trolls in my timeline talking about calling me a union thug.
What does that even mean?
But wait, can we jump in? The CEO got a raise while all these things were happening.
Ooh. Exactly.
Triple his salary. What about that? Let's not be so quick to bash unions. Let's be clear.
Oh, they were all like,
union is I'm not happy with the teachers union. I'll say that. Not all unions are bad, but some unions are bloodsuckers, in my opinion, my humble opinion. Yeah. But don't blame the union for this. This is years of mismanagement.
Exactly.
Yes. That's what that comes from. Let's be clear about that. Let's switch up for something a little bit more serious, guys.
More serious?
Yes.
Oh, I don't know.
I don't know what I'm talking about.
Anybody
here
have Instagram? If you have Instagram, guys.
Really?
No. Raise my hand.
All right, thank you. If you guys have Instagram, make sure you follow us. Okay, Grandma, we know you still got your Walkman.
Oh my God. I gotta defend her because I feel a little bit bad that she's called Grandma. I'm here. I'm defending you today.
Thank you, Lenny.
You're welcome.
You're more like a mom.
She's talking about your ginger snap. She's gonna give you $5 for your birthday.
I don't even know what a ginger snap is.
Ginger snaps are pretty good. I'm not even gonna lie.
She's doing a cat daddy. Kwanzaa's like, girl, are you having a seizure? Sugar
oh
child.
My God.
No, but if you guys have Instagram, be sure to follow us. Be Heard Radio. Yes, we're on Instagram as well. And there was a picture circulating on Instagram this past week. It was a headline that said George Zimmerman sentenced to 45 years to life for the murder of Trayvon Martin. I want to be clear right now, guys. That is 175.6810% false. The trial has not even started yet. The trial will not start until June 2013. You guys should stay up to date and make sure you still know what's going on, because this is going to be a big case. And at the end of the day, someone lost their life. And if you haven't been following, one of the things they found out was, A, Trayvon, the young man who was shot by George Zimmerman, his DNA was not found on a gun. As you guys know, Zimmerman said that Trayvon reached for the gun. And B, Trayvon actually was alive for a couple of minutes after he was shot.
I didn't know that.
Yeah.
I didn't know that either. I thought he died on spot.
He was alive for about 10 to 15 minutes afterwards, which the coroners have said, he was in extreme pain, and it was not a pretty sight. So those are two things. Also, George Zimmerman, he's been fighting and pushing to get Trayvon's school to release his transcript, because Trayvon was apparently suspended from school for having marijuana on him, and they want to show that he had traces of marijuana substances in his bloodstream. Off the record, I don't smoke weed. I know more than enough people who smoke weed. I'm from Brooklyn. Of course, I know people who smoke weed. Weed is not a kind of a drug unless it's laced with something that's going to make you act crazy. Right. Weed is a downer.
It really
and
is.
And if you guys don't know what a downer is, it's a relaxer. It's a depressor. Not a depressor. It's a relaxer. It slows you down. It makes you lethargic.
Hungry.
Yeah, definitely hungry. It's not going to make you run after somebody or go get a gun. But even so, don't worry, guys. If you're supporting the Trayvon Martin family, they only found traces of marijuana in the system, which wouldn't be enough to have him high at the time of the case. It means it may have been left over from like a couple of days or even weeks ago. But I want to update you guys on what was going on with the Trayvon Martin thing.
It makes me sad that was circulated and people immediately were like, oh my God, it's true. Because it shows you how literate in media most of us are. You know, I know that sounds like a very terrible word, but we really are. And it's not, you know, we can read, but we refuse to go and get the information for ourselves. We see a picture and we just share. And I've seen that a lot on Facebook.
Yep.
It happens. I got to the point that when people start sharing things that are wrong, I tell them and I link them to the correct information because it makes me sad. I was just like, you know what? I can't just stay here and watch them, you know, share this information that is obviously wrong.
I agree.
And listen, guys, you don't have to just rely on your Facebook and your Twitter for news. You can always go to our website. We do a quickie and a news roundup article on our page at least twice a week. Our website is lyvbh.com, and we have some great content there. I cannot stress that enough. Patricia always writes these great op-eds that she posts on both her blog and on our website. And speaking of Patricia, she wrote an editorial inspired by an event that happened to her friend, and she's already raised, I think, over $1,500.
Oh, no, I'm over that. I'm up $2,300 now. A friend of mine who will remain anonymous, you know, an intruder came into her home, raped her while she slept, and she's still living in the same apartment where this happened, and that's a very bad, I mean, if anybody has been assaulted, especially sexually assaulted, it created a lot of PTSD, what it's called. It's like post-traumatic stress disorder, kind of what happens when you're at war, because you relive it every single time you walk into your apartment. So I'm trying to help her raise some funds so that she can move out of there, because she really doesn't make a lot of money. She doesn't have a lot of savings, and we have up to $2,300 now. So I am very excited to everybody who's donated.
But
I know great people.
If people who are listening now want to donate, where can they go?
Yep, they can go to my blog. It's Patricia Valoy, V as in Victor, ALOY.blogspot.com. There's a donate link, so if you want, go, please do so. And if not, just read and inform yourself. It's just really awareness is as important to fighting this issue as money.
It absolutely is. And, you know, a lot of people say when someone's raped, they say, oh, was a person, you know, provoking it? Or was it their, you know, were they walking down a dark alley? Were they doing something? Listen, rape is no one's fault. Don't blame anyone for rape. We need to make sure that we understand that. You cannot blame a victim. If someone's shot, you don't say why they stood in the way of the bullet. So if someone's raped, you can't say why they stand in the way of the person that's trying to rape them. Let's try to help this person, guys, because it could be your sister, daughter, wife, cousin, neighbor, friend.
Yep, it is. And like I said, victim blaming, you think that this is the one case where you'd be like, well, she was sleeping in her home. How can you blame her? People are like, why did you leave your window open? You know, why are you living alone? You know, what is a single woman doing in this neighborhood? There's so many ways that they find to just blame her for what happened. So don't be, I've had a lot of support, but I've got a lot of people who are just like, oh, well, why did you leave your window open?
Yeah,
that's frustrating.
It
really is.
They just seem to have some kind of warped mindset. Speaking of warped mindsets, guys, over 60,000 people in Texas alone have filed a petition to secede from the United States of America. If you guys don't know what seceding means, it means they want to separate themselves, their state, from the United States of America. The last time a state separated itself from the U.S. government from America was during the Civil War, when Abraham Lincoln was president, and the argument was slavery. So, this is not the first time someone has requested to secede again. It's happened plenty of times over the years.
It will forever.
It will forever.
People in Key West, I think, they've been trying to secede for a long time.
Yeah. And it was like just 2 years ago, there was a council member in Maine who wanted to separate Maine into two different states, from like the lowlands to the highlands. I forget exactly what it was.
What's the point of that?
It's not new.
I think they wanted to do that in California too, north and south, which,
yeah,
being from
that.
California, there are two very different regions, very different cultures politically and otherwise.
Yeah.
But
so is New York though. Like upstate is totally, I drive up there and it was Romney Ryan stickers all over the place.
But guys, I have a proposal. I'm going to cut you off. I'm sorry.
Oh, no, go ahead.
But what if we traded Texas for Puerto Rico? They want to be a state anyway, don't they?
Traded.
No,
and they have beaches.
Puerto Rico was actually on C-SPAN. Oh, I'm sorry, guys. On C-SPAN, on the 14th, the Republicans had their first meeting in response to the 113th Congress and the agenda. And at the top of the hour, they did discuss Puerto Rico and what they could do to make sure that they're on their side when all is said and done. Because they are, if you guys didn't know, Patricia did bring up last week or the week before that Puerto Rico is on the road to statehood.
Yep.
So we
voted on
definitely
it.
Keep track of that, because that's something to watch.
Heck
so
yeah.
Republicans actually have Puerto Rico on the top of their agenda.
Didn't they boo like the president of Puerto Rico at the RNC and it said U.S. Anyway.
Yeah, they did.
Yeah, that's going to work out real well.
The wife. Yeah, his wife.
But anyways, guys, I'm sorry. I said I motioned to Patricia to go on break, and in the midst of that, she just got really quiet because I thought I guess she expected me to say something.
Oh, I thought you were telling me to shut up.
No.
We were just soaking in the moment.
We were like,
Puerto Rico.
We had that awkward moment.
My mind is in a beat somewhere, man.
We are going to go on a quick break. When we come back, we'll be talking about Hurricane Sandy and Sandy.
Occupy Sandy.
Thank you very much. I had a brain freeze right there. And we'll also be talking about FEMA's stepchildren. We'll be back after this brief message. This is Rihanna, Diamonds.
To the universe as we moonshine and my lane, feel the warmth will never die. We're like diamonds in the sky. You're a shooting star I see, a vision of ecstasy. When you hold me, I'm alive. We're like diamonds in the sky. At first sight I felt energy. Like a diamond, shine bright like a diamond, shine bright like a diamond. So shine bright tonight, you and I. We're beautiful like diamonds in the sky. I do, I, so alive. We're beautiful.
First, gotta find me. What's 50 grand to a motherfucker like me? Can you please remind me? Ball so hard, it's crazy. Y'all don't know that, don't phase. And as we go, I'm 82 when I look at you like you're crazy. Ball so hard, we ain't need a pope, be here. Ball so hard, since we here, it's only right that we be fair. Psycho, I'm libo, go Michael. Take your pick, Jackson, Tyson, Jordan, game six. Ball so hard, got a broke clock. Rollies to go tick-tock. Mars, that's losing time, hidden behind all these big rocks. Ball so hard, I'm shocked too. I'm supposed to be locked up too. You escape, but I escape. You be in Paris, get passed up too. Ball so hard, let's get faded. Lobberies for like 6 days. Gold bottles, soul models, spilling ace on my sick days. Ball so hard, let's behave. Just might let you meet, yeah. Shot town, B-Rose, moving the next BK. Ball so hard, you wanna find me. That's great. That's great. That's crack. Ball so hard, wanna find me. That's crack. That's crack. That's crack. She said, yeah, can we get married at the mall? I said, look, you need to crawl for your bar. Come and meet me in the bathroom style.
Ball so hard, ball so hard. Sometimes I wish I was Jay-Z, but I'm not. I don't have his money either. We are back on Let Your Voice Be Heard, the show that plans to what is wrong with me today? The show that plans to educate, inform, and empower the people of our generation on important social and political issues. We are back here. We just finished the news roundup, and now we are getting ready to talk about Occupy Sandy and the relief efforts in the FEMA stepchildren areas like Far Rockaway, Coney Island, Staten Island, you know, pretty much low-income neighborhoods Red and areas Hook, like Red that. Hook. Red Hook, definitely Red Hook. So I'm really excited to do this segment. I'm covering it, and I haven't had a chance to be really involved in the relief efforts. I've been kind of tied up with work, but on my part, I've been doing a clothing drive and planning a benefit concert, but that's just something that's not, it's not right now work. So I want to do more. But one group which has been very involved with the relief efforts, and especially in these neighborhoods, and more so than FEMA, if you ask certain people, has been Occupy Wall Street, and in particular, Occupy Sandy. So today we're going to have a guest on the show. His name, he's on the phone actually, he's on the phone right now. His name is Sal, and he's from 113th Street, Rockaway Beach Boulevard, and is the founder of YANA, which is You Are Not Alone, an organization which is about encouraging self-starters and encouraging people to work for themselves and become entrepreneurs. Sal and YANA was, they had the first location where Occupy Sandy started working at. So, you know, he's been there from day one. When I called him yesterday, he was actually in the field working. When I called him this morning, he was in the field working. These guys have been amazing. So, Sal, thank you so much for taking our time right now to talk to us. Sal, you there?
Yes. Good afternoon.
Good afternoon, Sal.
Hi.
How you doing today, Sal?
Pretty good. A little worn out, but feeling good. Motivated.
I hear you, man. I hear you, man. So, Sal, you know, just really quickly for the listeners, please introduce yourself and what you do with your organization and what you've been doing in your neighborhood since Sandy happened.
Okay, my name is Sal Apizo. I started YANA, Y-A-N-A, which stands for You Are Never Alone. And it's, you know, an organization where we try and help the people in the area develop careers. Instead of just, you know, looking for jobs, we try to help people find careers and spark the entrepreneur in them with guys. Instead of becoming day workers, what they do is we help them to get their contractors' licenses. People that are women that are stuck home with kids, we try and help them turn their homes into a daycare center where they can, you know, make money, take care of their children, and then hire one or two people. So this is, you know, this is our theme. And right after the storm, I got wiped out. It took me about a year to get to the point where I was. And the storm came along and seemed like a disaster until a couple of guys from Occupy came by and asked me if they could use my place as, you know, as their main hub. I was ecstatic. I was like, of course, man, that's what I want to do. I want to be a community service. And the rest has been outrageous. I mean, I can't tell you how much they've helped me. You know, I try to stay out of politics. Grew up in the 60s, so I kind of got bored with politics. I'm just into people that just want to do something on their own, and they would just do it, and that's pretty much what they did. They came in, and they just, like, and they took care of every need that I could think of, from toiletries to food to gasoline to people with cars, pumping people out of their houses. I mean, I've never seen anything like that before. They just got together, they did it, and they did it in a great way.
That's very touching. That's amazing, actually.
It's so touching, he's crying. No, Sal, you're very inspirational, the work you do, not just right now for Hurricane Sandy, but what you did previously with YANA. That was incredible.
Well, you know, a lot of people say to me, you know, it's a disaster relief. I grew up in New York City my whole life. I mean, I've been in every project you can think of that there is. And, you know, people in the city, certain parts of the city, they're always in disaster mode. I mean, when a hurricane comes, you know, it's just another part of the game. And they're always in a disaster mode. They always need the help from somebody. And I really don't want to see them get help from anybody. I want to see them just stretch out and get help from themselves. Because I know that, you know, that they have it inside somewhere. It's just been buried. And I want to get it out. I don't want them to rely on anyone anymore.
That's very inspiring.
I hear about FEMA and I hear about some other organizations. I really don't want to knock them. I don't want to say anything about them. They do what they do. We do what we have to do.
So
that's really where it's at.
You know, you're hitting the nail right on the hammer. I want to get to that. But before we do, tell us a little bit about what your area looked like after the hurricane hit. I know I haven't been there yet. I was watching a movie on Hurricane Katrina yesterday with some friends and my frat brother who lives in Inwood, which is not too far from Far Rockaway. He says that's pretty much what his neighborhood looked like after the day after the hurricane. So can you just, you know, paint a picture for us very briefly. Paint a picture.
Well, I haven't been to New Orleans. And as I drove down, like, over the Cross Bay Bridge, there was plenty of FEMA. There was plenty of, government agencies. And they were up and down this boulevard guarding these banks. Just look at this. They're all lined up watching their dad in the banks. It's so funny. And then I came over the bridge, and it was like, you know, I was in New Orleans, pictures that I saw in New Orleans. It was just smoke, still burning buildings. My whole block was burnt out. Little shops that were there, people just gathering a few dollars to get together to open up like a little nail salon, and then a storefront church. And they were all wiped out, just burnt out. Even the Social Security office next to me was burnt out. But, you know, I was very fortunate. I just got a fled. And these guys came along, man, and they just went in, wiped out the whole flood, took everything out, gutted the place. We made shelves, and people just started showing up. They were actually showing up with boxes and cases of, like, quality stuff. And the people in the neighborhood, they felt they were not alone. You know, they got it. And people that weren't talking to each other before, different groups that kind of, like, you know, staying with their own people, they all just started throwing in and helping each other and directing traffic and pumping gas for people and giving kids, you know, Pampers and diapers. And I felt like I couldn't believe it. I just could not.
Wow, that's crazy, Sal.
It was a disaster that turned into, like, the biggest blessing I ever experienced.
I can totally understand. This is Kwanzaa. I was raised in Rosedale, Queens, St. Albans, Cambria Heights, those areas, which I'm sure you know we're District 31 collectively with Rockaway. So I campaigned out there a little bit for my idol, Jacques Leandre, who definitely helped out a lot and is still helping out a lot after Sandy and prior to Sandy. And what we did was the day after the storm, we just drove through Rockaway because I had to see with my eyes what I was being texted and tweeted and Facebooked about. Because as you know, you guys didn't get any media coverage, and you're still not getting the media coverage you deserve. So we drove through, and it had to be around 7-8 o'clock at night. And I've never seen anything like that in New York, point blank, period. Yeah. We drove through Mont Avenue. We were over there, and thank goodness for the shop owners who decided, you know, I'm not going to try to flip a profit. I'm just going to open my doors. Right. They were giving bags of supplies to families. Some I did see they were still selling things, but when I inquired, it was definitely at a discounted price. And neighbors were helping neighbors. But then unfortunately, when I got closer to the Beach 100s and I started to hear horror stories as to people getting their doors kicked in and being robbed and things of that sort. What have the media, we haven't seen much on TV, but have you seen the media out there, whether they have footage or not, but have you seen a media presence? And I know you don't want to speak badly about FEMA and other organizations, but have you seen the presence out there besides your organization, Occupy, people like Jacques Leandre, and my councilman Comrie? Have you seen a presence besides those type of people?
Well, you know, in the main shopping centers, like a wall-bound shopping center, they'd set up their tents and they'd put their lights on, they had bottles of water. But actually, you know, they made their presence like that. And if you went into the streets and into the blocks and into the people's homes and into the people's basements and actually finding people that just didn't make it, it had nothing to do with it had nothing to do with those people you're talking about. It was just plain kids coming out of Brooklyn, kids coming out of Queens, you know, volunteering, sticking a piece of duct tape on their shoulder and putting their name on it. Those are the people that were in there. They're still there. They're still there pumping people out. Mm-hmm. They're still there.
Yes.
You know, so as far as the media goes, they look for this, you know, we don't deal with that. Mm-hmm. You can't deal with that because,
right.
You know what I mean? I wish we could, you know, but it just doesn't work that way. So it's a system that doesn't work that way. So why even flood it? That's why I say that.
And so,
you know, why flood it? Just do what you have to do. You see a woman that needs a coat, give her a coat. You see a kid that needs you know, just give it to him. That's it. If you got it, you give it to him.
No, or just do it. Go ahead.
All right.
Yeah. And you know what? That's That's what proves more than anything. And then they'll follow. The other ones will follow.
Mm-hmm.
You're absolutely right.
Lead by example, definitely.
Yeah. We actually have someone who wants to ask you a question, Sal.
Go ahead, Tamara.
Hi, Sal. My name is Tamara. I'm a guest on the show today. And on that note of the media, I read a really interesting article yesterday in the New York Times that talked about this tendency in Far Rockaway. They also mentioned Red Hook. For the people who have lived there for very long periods of time, feeling this almost animosity towards certain people who've been coming into those neighborhoods to volunteer, typically people who were either not severely affected by the hurricane or were, but were able to kind of receive benefits and get their power back, their heat back at faster rates, and are of a different higher socioeconomic status than these people. And there were stories in there of, I think there was a man, he was an immigrant from Africa, whose 10-year-old daughter was approached by a white woman who bent down to her and said, "Have you eaten in the past 3 days?" And things like that. And people who are almost feeling like they're at some sort of zoo, like they're a spectacle for these people who are you know, coming out for the weekend to like volunteer in this kind of like war-torn looking post-hurricane terrain, and then are able to kind of return to their warm, heated, lit apartments in Midtown Manhattan. So I was just wondering, since you are constantly in this environment because you live in Far Rockaway, is this a tendency that you've seen? I mean, the article is really, really well reported, I think. And people were saying, you know, I wouldn't be upset if I never saw these people again. This is the only time that we're seeing people like this who are showing that they care about what's going on, only when severe situations like this happen. So my question for you is if you, I guess if you agree or if you've seen this kind of animosity, how these people are interacting.
Well, it's, you know, it's a fact. It's not, you know, you can understand that wholeheartedly. There are a lot of people that just come out of, you know, different environments, and they do have, you know, they come out of the Midwest or wherever the heck they came from, and that's what flooded Williamsburg, that's what flooded Dumbo, that's what flooded all these areas. Some of them are insensitive, and some of them just, you know, looking to get their degrees, and they look at it as so, the way that people feel it. Certain people do feel it that way. I understand that. I've been growing up with that my whole life. But, I mean, they have good intentions. And if they don't have good intentions, you know, that's what we've been doing all weekend, too. Like, are you here for the, you know, are you here for the day? You're going to help out for the day. So we understand, like, some people just want to get a little good karma and come out for the day. You know what I mean? So what are you going to say? Don't come out. But there are a lot of people that, you know, like they get it. They understand that the difference. And they really don't want to see that barrier. So they're trying to, you know, there are a lot of people that are trying to break that barrier.
Yeah.
And it goes the other way, too. You know, sometimes, like, you know, in my work, you know, I you know, I'm trying to help somebody out. And I'm telling them, like, listen, you got to show up for parole, man. You got to show up. It's as simple as that, you know. And he's just not going to show up. So what do? I can't go to his house and drag him.
Fair.
You know what I'm saying? So.
Well, you're helping out a lot. So this is Patricia. Sorry to cut you off, but the work that you're doing there, it's remarkable. You know, you don't go and you don't help people based on this organization that tells you what exactly you need to do. You just help people because they need it. And
I grew up in the '60s. I said that earlier. My family came out of Spanish Harlem. I mean, I've seen all the riots in those days. You know, a lot of people marched and a lot of people
experience.
Did a lot of things. And I'm at the point where, like, I'm close to 60. And I'm not going to get out in the street and start protesting.
We'll do that for you, Sal. You know, don't worry about it.
So I just, like, I know it is a need. I opened up a little place. I feel like I had a few hours that I could do something, make a difference.
Right.
And I just felt like there was an area that was, like, really, really abused.
Mm-hmm.
You know, these people are really, really abused. And I'm sick of it.
Right.
Online. So, you know, I could either talk shit about it.
Ooh.
I could talk bad things about, you know, a lot of the government issues. But it's not my game. My game is to help people, help them, you know, empower themselves. Mm-hmm. I don't want to see women going and marrying somebody to get a green card. I'm sick of that. That's not what this country is about.
Yeah.
That's what I wanted. I want to see these women get a Social Security card and go to work.
Right.
I want to see these guys on a corner begging for a job. I want to see them become contractors and hire other guys. I don't want to see people telling them, oh, you can fix a car. The car's obsolete. We're into solar panels. You want to learn a trade that's going to be the future? That's what we need to do. That's where we have to be, you know? And I've seen it happen in a lot of neighborhoods. I see some really nice African bakeries uptown. Why shouldn't they be everywhere?
Yeah, no.
Why shouldn't someone have some skills open up their own little
bakery? The community emergency response.
Yeah. I think somebody went to respond to me, Sal.
Man, I get carried away.
No, Sal.
I really appreciate the time that you're giving me.
No, Sal,
definitely. No, I appreciate the time you're giving us as well.
I'm passionate about it, so.
No, and I want you to continue, but we have to go on a quick break, Sal, okay? We're going to go on a quick break. Can you hang on for a little bit?
I guess I can.
All right. Thank you so much, guys. We're going to go on a quick break, guys. We're talking about Hurricane Sandy, the relief efforts from Occupy Sandy, and great people like Sal. We'll be right back after this quick message from the Community Relief Bank, I guess. I don't know.
The Community Emergency Response Team, or CERT of New York City, provides assistance in preparing and recovering from emergencies. CERT assists first responders and provides staffing for city shelters in response to disasters and extreme weather conditions. City College is one of the many locations for hurricane evacuation. CERT team members are local and live amongst the community, so they are always there for the people. CERT members will speak to any organization about emergency planning for the elderly, children, and the disabled. They offer workshops in creating go bags, emergency communication, and evacuation plans, and shelter-in-place kits. To learn how to prepare for emergencies, call South Harlem CERT at 917-406-6661.
WHCR 90.3 FM, New York.
And we are back on Let Your Voice Be Heard on 90.3 FM WHCR, the Voice of Harlem. We have been talking about the Occupy Sandy and their relief efforts with our good friend Sal and his organization YANA. It's been getting pretty good in here, and I just want to kind of backtrack a little bit and talk more so about the relief efforts. So, Sal, thanks for sticking in with us. Can you tell me some of the things that you guys have been doing, just very quickly, pinpoint four or five things that Occupy Sandy and you and your organization have done in the community since the hurricane hit to help to improve things.
Yeah, I think the first thing was to get hot food out. That was the most important thing. Get food out, get lights, flashlights and batteries so people felt a little bit of secure in their own home. Most of them were really, really flooded out. Then after those couple of days, we started going in and helping them get the water out of their apartments and gutting and putting a lot of their stuff out on the street. And then also, for the children, a lot of children that needed warm blankets and Pampers and stuff like that, the toiletries, all that kind of stuff was in big demand. We got so flooded with it that we had to, we helped like about four or five other churches start up. And it just took off from there. That's really what they needed.
All right. Just cut you off. Pardon me. What about FEMA? Where was FEMA when all this was happening?
Well, they're, like I said, their presence was seen, but not felt. They were just kind of like on standby. I don't know. I really don't even know what they're supposed to do. I think they're just looking for people that are going to start looting, I was there, I didn't see any looting. You might have seen a little petty stuff here and there, but I didn't see any looting, out-and-out looting like you did back in the days when there was a blackout and people went, free-for-all. I didn't see any of that. I didn't feel that, Maybe in certain areas it happened a little bit here and there, but I think a lot of that stuff is always overrated. I think a lot of times people, they want a reason to crack down on other people, and they use that, I didn't feel that at all. And, that was it. I can't say enough for the people that came in. like you say, you know, on a weekend you'll see people driving around and just like, ooh, ah, taking pictures. And it does kind of feel like, you know, come on, man.
Like you zoo. Do feel like it's a zoo.
Yeah, it's like, you know, come on. And go to the Bronx, go ride the tram on the Bronx Zoo and do it, you know, spend, take your kids there.
Exactly. So this is Kwanzaa again, and I'm back on the media thing. So I was one of the people who, I was one of the people who had to see it for myself, only because, again, Rockaway isn't, was in my district. I'm no longer District 31.
Right.
But we also needed to see the damage to see how many volunteers or how many people from our neighborhood in Rosedale, which is right across Snake Road from Rockaway, right on the other side of Five Town, could be there. And now you mentioned you weren't sure exactly what FEMA's role was. But the thing about it for us with I didn't have power, but I stayed somewhere where they did have power. What we saw in the news in places like Jersey and Long Beach and South Shore and places like that was the FEMA tents with supplies, baby formula, National Guards, giving those things directly to the residents of those areas. Now, when I went the second time to Rockaway actually to get my hands dirty, that's when I noticed that that activity wasn't happening. I did notice on the news that people like, again, Jacques Leandre, Erica Ford, of course, Occupy Sandy, who was there from day one, I noticed that they were the people who people were coming to.
Right.
So it's a shame that you don't know what FEMA was there for in your area. However, on the news, what was portrayed of about FEMA was they were the knight in shining armor.
Right.
Yeah. Well, it's always going to be the way. And then, you know, it's the same thing with some of these other medical teams. I mean, again, I really don't want to do it, but I'll do it. You know, like the Red Cross. I mean, they're on TV collecting money all over the world, and here we are in New York City,
with
some of the best hospitals on the planet, with some of the best medical teams on the planet, and they asked me if I wanted water.
Wow. and
it's like,
Sal,
the whole ocean. Walk one block away, you'll find a whole ocean of water. We need medical supplies. We need nebulizers, kids. We have the highest rate of asthma in the country, right here in New York City.
You're right.
We don't have medical supplies. Okay, then I really don't need your help. Thank you. I appreciate your presence. Have a nice day.
And they didn't provide any. Sorry to cut you off, but
steps, zero, none. We set up our own medical staff. We have volunteers coming from all over the city.
Mm-hmm.
And right now, there's a big problem with the respiratory
because of all the
stuff that's airborne. We were able to set up one on 113 across the street from my office and another one down on 38th Street, and it's been a struggle with that.
That's really good. And I know I can tell that you said FEMA, you know, hasn't been able to provide the things that you need. But, you know, in terms of medical attention, Doctors Without Borders, they're actually for the first time ever have been helping out with Hurricane Sandy victims in the United States. Have you seen any of them or have you even heard?
I met them on the first day or two they came. They were very, you know, we thought like, okay, cool.
Okay.
You know, I mean, who has a better rep than them, right?
Right.
But a lot of these, you know, but they set up and then I have some doctors coming in and different people coming in. And I was like, listen, follow their protocol. Whatever they set up, that's what we'll follow.
Right.
I'm not an MD, you know. So, I assured them that I would keep everything, you know, under lock and key, all the prescriptions, all that kind of stuff.
Mm-hmm.
We were trying to, like, work with them. They set up, but then they cut out.
Oh, wow.
So Occupy actually set it up and got with their own doctors, volunteers. They're still over there now. Been there every single day, and we try to get a protocol going. We try to get the pharmacies, one or two pharmacies. It didn't work out. We had to get somebody else, and the pharmacy started opening up. 2 days ago, we finally got light on the street from a generator from the police department. I mean, everywhere else was lit up. Our block, there was no light.
Wow. Sal.
I'm telling you.
Sal.
And if it wasn't for Greenpeace, we've had electricity from day one with Greenpeace. They put up a solar panel truck.
Wow. We didn't hear about that.
Oh, this is awesome. Let me tell you something. We've had electricity from day one. I just signed a contract. It's amazing how this is happening because I just signed a contract with a guy to do solar, and what I wanted to do is teach young men and young women about solar energy. Didn't have to get off the grid, not rely on anybody else. And when that happened, I was like, there goes that project.
Yep.
And who pops up because of Occupy was Greenpeace.
You're a superhero, Sal.
They brought mobile solar panel trucks, and we've had electricity the whole time.
That's amazing. Now, Sal, we're running out of time, so I'm going to do two things before we actually get out of here. The first thing I'm going to do is I want you to very briefly tell people what they can do and who they need to contact if they want to help. If they want to go out there right now, what they need to do, who they need to contact, let us know right now.
Okay, right now, you can come to Yana. We have a volunteer station set up. And, you know, whatever your expertise are, it's medical, construction, whatever it is, they'll evaluate you and send you to where you have to go. It's on 113th Street and Rockaway Beach Boulevard, Yana.
So 113th Street and Rockaway Boulevard, Yana. And you can take
Rockaway
the H train there?
Beach Boulevard.
Oh, Rockaway Beach Boulevard. Pardon me.
And 1694 if they want to put it in their navigator.
Mm-hmm.
And the other thing is also the same thing with the food. Or you can just go online and look up Yana, or you can look up Occupy. Right. Or you can bring food there, and what we do is we distribute it to five different locations.
All right, that is wonderful. Now, really quickly, Sal, if people want to learn more about Yana, let us know, because we got to get out of here. So let us know where they can learn more about Yana from.
You can go online. I would rather you just come down, man.
Fair enough, man.
I want you to come down. You know, you can read books all day, you can look on the internet all day, but this is interaction, people to people. This is what we're lacking, and we want to create a neighborhood. I want to create not a blog, a neighborhood.
Right.
You know? So come on down, meet some nice people, some decent people, break the barriers. Let's get away with, you know, us against them. It's all us. That's the bottom line.
Love that.
All about us. No more us again.
Beautifully said, Sal.
Alone. Thank you. God bless you. And I appreciate your show because we need more shows like you.
Thank you very much, Sal. And thank you so much for calling us a guest. We really appreciate it. That was Sal, guys. He is the founder of Yana. He's been working very hard with Occupy Sandy and Occupy Wall Street to produce relief efforts to the people who were affected by Hurricane Sandy, in particular in Far Rockaway. Make sure you volunteer. We got to get out of here, so go on to the quickie with Kwanzaa. Grandma's doing a quickie, which is going to be a marathon. Before we do that, guys, I just want to close out this segment right here. As someone who was a strong supporter of Occupy in the beginning, as someone who was very inspired by that movement, it was very disappointing for me when there came a time where I felt I didn't identify with it anymore, and I felt that it had lost, you know, its purpose, or the thing that drove me and inspired me, it was gone. And there has been nothing more satisfying than seeing Occupy come to the forefront of doing the kind of work that we all need to do. So those of you who said Occupy was dead, you were absolutely wrong. For me, who thought that Occupy had lost its way, I was absolutely wrong. It is good to see that the people who started off for the people are now serving the people. And that's what it's all about. That's what it should always be. Sal, thank you so much for calling in today. We enjoyed the interview. We're going to go on a quickie with Kwanzaa. That's going to happen real quick. Going to go on a break for 1 second.
On a real quick quickie.
Yeah, on a real quick quickie. We're going to go on a break right now, guys. We'll be right back. This is Let Your Voice Be Heard on 90.3 FM WHCR, The Voice of Harlem.
Veterans have difficulty transitioning their military skills into civilian jobs. In New York City, an estimated 17,300 veterans are unemployed. Are you a veteran in desperate need of help? Do you want to take advantage of a life-changing opportunity? If so, the 369th Veterans Outreach Program is designed to assist veterans in Harlem and surrounding communities. Veteran services include resume preparation, interview workshops, access to interview attire, and reliable transportation. For more information, call the 369th Veterans Outreach Program at 646-533-9292.
There's a fire starting in my heart, reaching a fever pitch, and it's bringing me out the dark.
And we are back on Let Your Voice Be Heard on 90.3 FM, The Voice of Harlem. If you have any questions, comments, concerns, or just things to say, give us a call on 212-650-6903. And now we got Kwanzaa, Big Mama Kwanzaa Grandma.
Oh, my God.
With a cookie. Make
hey
it feel
guys.
Good.
I'm going to be very quick with this. And that's all I'm going to say. Patricia, Papa.
Oh, you're going to make us climax?
Yes. That's what the quickie is.
No, it's going to be inforgasmic. Relax.
Thank you. Okay, so my mentee is here, and you guys just made her turn red.
Tell me more.
Okay. Oh, my gosh. Okay, so let's do this because we don't want Brother Leroy to come up in here and shut it down. So we're going to do Congress in less than 10 minutes. So Congress is important because the Constitution says it is. We don't hear that the president did not get the respect of Article 1 in the Constitution. It is dedicated to Congress. He comes up in Article 2, and it's very short.
What's Article 1?
What is Article
1? Article 1 is about Congress. So I'll break it down.
Yeah.
The U.S. Congress has an upper chamber, which is called the Senate, and a lower chamber, which is called the House of Representatives. They share legislative power alone. The president has nothing to do with it.
Right.
Senate has 50 states elect two senators, each for a term of 6 years. They represent one of 37 million people. So, and it depends on the state's population. There are only 100 seats.
And that's for the House of Representatives or the Senate?
The House has 435 districts. We don't know what's going to happen with Puerto Rico. Shout out to Puerto Rico. And they have the House, they only have 2 years, two terms.
I didn't even know it was that quick, to be honest with you.
Yeah, their term is only two.
I thought it was longer.
Has a six-year term.
Oh, I see.
Yes, that's what's going on with them. Okay. And,
she's like, we're all right.
I'm trying to get through this.
Moving on. It's like taking clothes off.
Yes. I just flipped through.
Yeah, that's the shirt. Take your pants off. Go ahead.
So, we are currently in our 112th Congress, which is termed the lame duck Congress.
Aww.
Because they have not been doing anything this term. Okay, so due to filibusters and struggles for power and the polarization, all of that good stuff. Currently, the 112th Congress boasts 51 Republicans in the Senate and 47 Democrats. In the House, there's 241 Democrats, 193 Republicans. That's in our current Congress, which ends December, the last day.
And that seems kind of almost fair, and still, there's so much polarity.
So much polarity.
I mean, it's not half and half, but it's fair enough, I think.
And the 112th Congress has 94 females members of Congress, including our own Senator Christine Gillibrand.
You're right.
They're responsible for
there goes the pants. See, she flipped the page.
Flipped the next page.
So,
let's talk about what's new and what's fun.
You're down to your underwear.
About the 113th Congress. What's great about them is that this is the most diversified Congress that we've ever had.
Yeah, she smacked
the history. I smacked the table in the history of the United States. We have 4 new African Americans, 10 new Latinos,
whatever you people are called,
5 new Asians, 24 new females, new women in House and the Senate.
Also LGBT, there's like
There are four.
Libigators?
Yes. And then what's exciting is we have 4 new members who were born or made in the 80s. That's really exciting.
Wow, it's one of us.
Yes, so we have a younger Congress this time around.
I didn't even know that.
Yes, let's talk about religion. We have 3-minute mark.
You're right. She can do
three
that.
3 minutes. We can
go ahead. Let's talk about religion as you take off your underwear.
This is our first Congress where we have a Hindu.
Uh-huh.
And we have a Buddhist.
Oh, yeah.
And we have a non-theist.
Woo!
Unitarian Universalist.
Viva la atheist!
No Scientologist?
Oh, wait, no Scientologist. And back to
no
LGBT.
Mormons?
We have 4 new LGBT. And the first openly gay man of color in Congress.
You're right.
And the first bisexual.
If you have a gay black man in Congress, they know this?
Yes, we do. And he knows. And
Obama knows it.
And we all know. And they voted for him. So that's cool.
That shows you we're changing demographics. We really started caring. We started to see that these people, they make a difference in our lives. I know they do. I am so tired of old white men.
She's tired. Okay, so let's get to
You tired me out. This quickie. Woo.
Patricia's favorite part of this quickie.
The climax.
Women.
Woo.
Okay. So, in 2013, January 2nd, we can say that we will have 101 women between the House of Representatives and Senate. That's so exciting. Yes, 81 members or whatever my
math says. That's inspirational.
In the House Representative and 20 senators. So people we need to look out for are Elizabeth or Liz Warren, who sat on the committee for the financial for financial reforms. She's responsible for the Credit Card Act as well. She has some
smart
input.
Woman.
So we can look for.
She's from Massachusetts, right?
Yes, she is. We can look for some financial reform. And then there's Heidi. I'm sorry, Heidi. I don't even know how to say that last name. But I got excited when you said that I don't want to do a Selena, that you're into energy and natural resources. And then we have a Republican who we need to look out for. She's a Tea Partier. Her name is Susan Brooks. And she's down for Homeland Security, which will touch on immigration.
Hey.
So coming up, we can look for talks on, of course, equal pay. Clearly, LGBT issues, equal rights, energy, education reform, financial
reform. And these are the people who can actually do something.
And these are something can do something because Article 1, Section 1 of the U.S. Constitution says all legislative power were granted and shall be vested in the Congress of the United States, which consists of the Senate and the House, not the President.
Right.
And Section 1. Article 1, Section 8 gives them a billion.
You should really say that. I would be like, in there, it says that.
Yeah, no, they have like a million billion powers, and unfortunately, the president only has two.
I am so
let's get it together. This
excited.
Is important. Thank you for the quickie. I hope it was informative.
All right, Kwanzaa, that felt awesome.
I'm panting.
I would not read the Constitution. I don't read Constitution during quickies.
Sorry, I would probably do
we
that.
We could call her grandma, and then we totally went over and flipped the switch.
Emancipation Proclamation. Yes. Well, all right, guys, we have got to get out of here. We will be back very soon.
Next Sunday, actually.
That's Thanksgiving, so I didn't know if we'd be here. So
we didn't even.
We'll be back. We'll let you guys know real soon. We love you. We appreciate you all listening. Check out our website, lyvbh.com. Right now, we're going to finish off with Beyonce Girls Run the World and watch out for Brother Leroy, who is in here, and he will be here real soon because he finished on time for the first time in weeks.
Is right. Happy birthday, Selena. We miss you
Shout
so very
out.
Much. Woo!
But really, Selena, this is for you, too.
WHCR 90.3 FM, New York.
Shortness of breath, cold sweats, nausea, dizziness. If you know. I'm done. If any stuff familiar, call 911.
Learn a song that could save your life. Get a free download at womenshealth.gov/heartattack.
When will listen to me and when I'm done. If any stuff familiar, call 911. If any stuff familiar, call 911.
A message from the U.S. Department of Health and Human Services.
911.
Hi, this is Calvin Burrell, inviting you to join me each Saturday at midnight until 4 a.m. Sunday morning for the best in reggae music right here on WHCR 90.3 FM. Everything will be Irie.
Praise Hallelujah, everybody. This is DJ Flame, and I'm your host every Wednesday from 5 a.m. to 8 a.m. on the Anointed Mic Check, where we take beats back to Jesus, bringing you the best in urban gospel music, where you hear hip-hop, R&B, house, remixes, the Caribbean flavor, artist interviews, reviews, and so much more, whatever God just drops in my spirit. Now, I'm your host every Wednesday mornings from 5 a.m. to 8 a.m. Don't forget, the show is the Anointed Mic Check, and this is where we serve up urban gospel at its best. See you then.
Hi, I'm Vinny B of the Vinny B Showcase. Tune in every Thursday from 8 to 12 midnight for some solid cultural roots music and some sweet lovers rock. Also, informative interviews and giveaways. Right here on the Vinny B Showcase every Thursday, 8 to 12 midnight on WHCR 90.3 FM. Peace. I'm tougher than rock.
WHCR 90.3 FM, New York.
WHCR 90.3 on the FM dial, coming to you from the campus of City College in Harlem, USA. The program that you're about to hear, The Communicators, does not reflect the views, attitudes, whimsies, or any other proclivities of the management of WHCR, nor that of the administration of City College. However, the program does reflect the research done by the participants in the program, who are live and living color in studio by phone interview. And of course, there is you, ladies and gentlemen, brothers and sisters, the first class citizens of the world. I'm Brother Leroy, and accompanied by the great Wonder Man, Senkei. And let's see whether we have our. Okay, we it's very interesting. First call that come in don't work. And we are here at WHCR. Telephone number is 212-650-6903. 212-650-6903. When we open up the lines, we have Altimatics on tap for today, and maybe some other luminaries, but everybody that we have, including yourself, ladies and gentlemen, the first-class citizens of the world, are extremely valuable for sharing and imparting information that all of us can use. We thank the Most High for blessing us with another day on this good earth, another day to do some good deeds for ourselves, our families, for humanity. And when we do 10 good deeds a day, good morning, how are you? Hey, have a fantastic day. Your child looks very great. Those twins are fantastic. God bless you. When we do those kind of salutations and sincere greetings, that's a good deed. Make somebody else feel good. So when they say, oh, there's that lady, she always got a smile. She's always saying something positive. Be that way. and you'll see how you can make a big change. Stay tuned. We will be right back.
Experiment Black Radio.
Yo, sucker, never play me. Triple shade of black, then my bleach should never fade me. They say he crazy, New York, raised him in the 80s. Killer Koch administration, gangster renovation. Born in isolation, Asian ill communication. Asian Marvel, fight by acting, pestilential, microscopic soul, sonic remedy. Clinic right in the street, operating in the dark. Surgery, you in the heart. Come together, pill apart, come together. Smoking on something good, praying for something better. From out of better, never rocking. Forever, ever, 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 ever. It's still a secret.